We're going to go ahead and call the meeting to order and do the Pledge of Allegiance. That leaves it up to you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, sir. Can we do roll call, please?
Councilmember Cronin?
Here.
Councilmember Osorio?
Here.
Councilmember Rocha?
He may come in, but we started right on time. Public comment is limited to 2 minutes today, and a general public comment should be on items that are on our agenda. Not on our agenda, but in the purview of the land, housing and land use. Sorry, I've got a lot going on in my head today. We have one item on the consent agenda. It is the minutes from the June 7th Housing and Land Use Committee meeting. Is there any comment from the dais?
No comment.
Is there any comment from Commerce? Did we get any comment? No. Any from the audience? No. Can I have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second. And since there's only the two of us, I think we can forego the roll call vote. Motion carries. We have one consideration item. Actually, we have two consideration items. The first consideration item is ID 22-422, grants Clean California LSL Vibrancy Neighborhood Beautification, Highway US 101, and Clean California Local Grant Program, LSL Greening Beautification of Safety Improvements. Maria is going to give us a great presentation. You know what, before you start, I should have started with thanking everyone for coming today, and welcome back to the chambers. Go right ahead, Maria.
Good afternoon. Today's presentation is for two Clean California grant awarded projects for the city. The first one is the local grant, the Clean California Local Grant Program happening in the LSL. The project name is LSL Greening Beautification and Safety Improvements Project. And the second project is the State Beautification Project, or the Clean California State Beautification Program. Also, the name for the project is the Salinas LSL Vibrancy Neighborhood Beautification Project. Both projects are happening in the LSL community, the East LSL, also known as the East LSL. These both projects are being presented to City Council as consent items this month. And the first one, the Clean California Local Grant Program, is presented to City Council today for the execution of a restricted grant agreement with Caltrans for the city for the Clean California Local Grant Program. Accepting the Clean California Local Grant Program funds in the amount of $2,147,958, and the execution of an agreement between the City of Salinas, the Transportation Agency for Monterey County, or TAMC, and Ecology Action, which defines a partnership between the City of the City, TAMC, and Ecology Action, and a contribution of $149,955 from TAMC towards the project. And there will be a transfer of $156,896 from the ABP CIP 9246 to the project. The second, and I'll start with the first project. And as I said, the project is located in the general area of the LSL. And this map shows the limits of the LSL as per the LSL Vibrancy Plan. The LSL Vibrancy Plan provides a vision of the East Salinas community, the LSL, with the specific actions and policies generated through a community-led process. In 2019, City Council accepted the LSL Vibrancy Plan as a strategic planning document. In this past fiscal year, City Council appropriated approximately $3 million for immediate and short-term implementation activities of the LSL Vibrancy Plan. Short-term activities include of the LSL Vibrancy Plan include cleanliness, appearance, infrastructure, parks, and open space in the LSL, and to promote economic development of the LSL. And last fall, Caltrans launched the Clean California program, which is a more than $1 billion program allocated towards the Clean California local grant program. Roughly a third of that $1 billion is allocated towards local projects, and another third is allocated towards state beautification projects happening along the state's highway system. The program is a transformative initiative to remove litter, create jobs, and beautify California, and also to beautify public spaces and create recreational walking and healthier, encourage residents or local residents to for more recreational. The LSL Greening, Beautification, and Safety Improvements, it's an effort between TMC, Ecology Action, and Salinas, along with the Clean California grant funds. And the improvements of this project include greening and beautification along the LSL Street corridor between King Street all the way to the Skyway Boulevard roundabout. There is, and I will go into more details on these improvements in the next slides. There's also the Safe Routes to School sidewalk art and educational programming component, where TMC, along with Ecology Action, will be installing sidewalk art throughout roughly 5 miles of streets or safe routes connecting to 7 schools, to 2 parks, La Paz Park and the Cluster Park, and the Red Box Recreational Center, and also the Cesar Chavez Library. Another component of the project is the Cluster Park mural beautification at the community center, or also known as the Salinas Boxing Club, and installation of historical markers throughout the park. And then there's also the frontage improvements at the Bread Box Recreation Center. The improvements at the LSL Street corridor include installation of banners on existing streetlight poles, restoration of existing benches, installation of new trash enclosures, trash and recycling receptacles, where new artwork will be included in those trash recycling receptacles, installation of wayfinding signage, installation of drought-resistant shrubs, and installation of new trees. And this is just identifying the location for those proposed improvements. And this is what we submitted with the application and the existing conditions along the LSL Street corridor. At the Skyway Boulevard, these are existing conditions where drought-resistant plants will be installed, and more specifically to the left, lower left, that's where new drought-resistant plants are being installed. For the Breadbox Recreation Center, this is just an image of what will be happening, what is proposed. The new resistant, drought-resistant plants are being proposed along with trees, new trees, and a sculpture, an art sculpture, along with an MSD shelter for the existing bus stop. At the Closter Park, these are the existing conditions, and like I said, a new mural is proposed at the Salinas Boxing Club along with historical markers throughout the park. The currently the budget for the project is roughly $2.4 million. The Clean California Local Grant Program award consists of $2.1 million. TAMSI will be contributing roughly $150,000 towards the project, and the city will be utilizing APP funding and in the amount of $156,000. And like I said, this item is being presented to City Council today. Roughly going over the project schedule, we are currently in the process of requesting a proposal for consultants for district identity for the LSL. And as we move through the process, the artists, it's currently scheduled to select the artists and their design in January of 2023, finalizing the plans in I believe at around the same time, and advertise the project in April of 2023, and to begin construction as soon as July of next year. The project does need to be completed by June of 2024. That is one of the requirements of the grant for this project. And now moving into the Clean California Beautification Project, which for the city is the LSL Vibrancy Neighborhood Beautification Project happening along Highway 101. This project is located at the Market Street Underpass, at the LSL Street Underpass, and at the Sanborn Road Underpass. The project includes new murals at the Market Street and at the Sanborn Road Underpasses. Lighting for the murals is also proposed at all three locations. And at the LSL Street, there's existing murals, we're proposing to expand the existing murals at the LSL Street underpass. These are existing conditions at these project locations. And these are just samples of community murals at bridge murals for other communities with lighting. And we recently selected the final artist for all locations. And the process that we went through is in April, we staff circulated a community survey where we obtained ideas, color, and what the community wanted to see in these murals. In May, a call to artists was released, and then it closed in June 22nd, where 42 artists. There were 42 artist submissions. And of those 42 artist submissions, there were at least 6 local artists submissions. And this was narrowed down to 9 artists, 3 per location. And just recently, I want to say about 2 weeks ago, one artist was selected for each of these locations. And that's where we currently are. We are asking City Council at their August 23rd meeting to execute a cooperative agreement with Caltrans in the country where the city will be contributing $100,000 towards the project. Also, execution of a maintenance agreement where the city is assuming maintenance of the painted murals and the new lighting for the murals, and transaction of the $100,000 being contributed for the project from CIP, Capital Improvement Program 9246, which is the Alisal Vibrancy Plan. This is the initial design for the selected artwork at Sanborn Road. And this is the initial design for the Market Street underpass. And this is the expansion of the existing murals at the Alisal Street underpass. This still has to under, we will still be engaging the community in the next 1 to 2 months for the artists to finalize the design.
Maria, are we going to get to meet the artist? At some point, can he come to council, or they, I don't know if it's a he or not, and meet, just be introduced to council? I think that'd be nice.
Okay. And other improvements happening include landscaping enhancements, which is seedlings of poppy seeds and blue eye angel, I believe, seeds along the embankment of those bridges, along with fencing at Market, on the east side of Market Street. Sorry, the northwest side of Market Street. And that's looking more like, I believe, between the second to the left. I think that's what Caltrans is looking to as far as fencing goes. And currently the project is on budget. However, due to the continuous delay in the chain supply, or backlog in the chain supply, and the increase in construction material, and because the project is right on budget, that's why staff is proposing to enter into this cooperative agreement with Caltrans to show the city's commitment for the project. The project is currently being fully funded through the Clean California grant in $1,870,000. And in addition to that, Caltrans has moved the fencing and the slope paving under a separate project, which is the Clean Up California, funded through Caltrans as well. And so the city really, we would really like to see the project happen. And that's why we're presenting the going through this cooperative agreement request. And the schedule for this project is happening a little fast. This project is due for completion in June of next year. And here's just the schedule for what is coming up next. And in November, the project is estimated to begin construction in November this year. And thank you.
Thank you. Let's go to my left for questions.
Thank you for your presentation. One of the slides that you had here mentioned of the many benefits from this program, one will be to create jobs. Is that going to be local jobs, or is that just in general speaking statewide through the program, there's jobs can be created?
It's the program is to create jobs throughout the state. We did, in going through the artist selection, we staff did include, we wanted to focus the call to artists with the local artists. And like I said, there were 6 to 7 artist submissions from the county, Monterey County. Of those, there were, was it 3 or 4?
4
that are local. Selena's local artist, and unfortunately, due to the requirements of these murals, which are being installed on traffic, very heavy traffic areas, it does require the expertise and the experience of artists who have done work, just for the safety and also for the, in order for the project to meet the schedule.
So then Selena's person didn't get the final selection?
Unfortunately, no, not the Selena's local artists.
As part of the allocation that the city is going to give to the project, could it be a consideration that we allocate a little bit more to perhaps provide some sort of an opportunity for local artists to assist in this, maybe on a smaller scale in the project? I say that because if you look at communities like Los Angeles, especially Boyle Heights and others, they've had a really difficult time getting the community to buy into a project when they feel like their own people are being snubbed in the process of creating artwork in their community.
So just to clarify, Councilmember Rocha, there was a local artist selected for the Alixal, and that was the group La Neta. They're not based out of Salinas, but they are based in County of Monterey. The notion with the other two artists that were selected is that they will be working with local artists to help them out, as well as we will be doing a community outreach for all three underpasses to include the youth through the process. And then the final, those were just somewhat final. There's still the opportunity to make changes based on community outreach that we'll be doing in the involvement of local artists. The majority of them, even the ones that weren't selected, were mentioning that since they weren't from the area, they were going to work with local artists to help them, because it is a big task. It's big murals. Again, one of the reasons, as my colleague Maria mentioned, the reason they weren't selected was because of the job that it requires, the heavy traffic and the experience that is needed for that majority. Talking to the Monterey Arts Council, they also thought of, in future, looking for future, something that would benefit our local artists is to group them with these other artists from other communities that have done bigger projects for in the future, if there's opportunities, they meet those requirements.
Yeah, and I see Megan's there in case Megan would.
Yeah.
Well, and I know you worked in Los Angeles, Megan, so maybe you could provide some insight.
Yeah. Well, I was just gonna mention that the other grant does involve 2 murals, and those are being done by local artists. It's really about, for us, I think, building the capacity of local artists to do these bigger projects. So we're very much aligned with you on that. And I think we have a big opportunity in the Alasal through even the other money to do public art installations even beyond what we're talking about. And that's where I know that Oscar expressed that we're being very instrumental in making sure that there's training, because these underpasses are highly specialized. You have to have the capacity, and we're trying to build that up.
Yeah. No, thank you for your responses on that. I would say that I know you mentioned they're going to be working with the local artists. I would hope that that work, in whatever degree, includes payment to those local artists. Because one thing's to say, we want you to get the experience, so you could do one on your own, but you could do it for free, and we won't pay you, but yet someone who's not from Salinas gets paid, right? So ideally, I'd like for those Salinas artists to also get paid in that process. I know one of the areas that had a proposed new mural has an existing mural. So what's going to happen with the existing murals in the city?
The existing mural is staying the same. It's just being restored. Okay. And I believe it already has the graffiti coat or seal. It's just being cleaned up and then restored if there's any damages to it.
Thank you. And as part of the money we're going to be allocating out of the ALSA Vibrancy Plan, is that part of the $3 million that was allocated last fiscal year but wasn't spent? I'm not getting my nods. Okay. And those are all of my questions.
Thank you, Council Member.
He doesn't know we're like...
Oh, yes, good on you.
Thank you.
Orlando.
Great job, by the way. I know that you guys will know the answers to this because you guys have spent a lot of time in the Alisal. I obviously live there, so I think I just might know a little bit more about the area. One of the things that really makes me an area of concern is that we're talking about like putting this really nice fencing around the area that is on Market Street. And I'm pretty sure we're familiar with it. One side of Market Street on that underpass, it has a waterway there, which is always the fencing is always getting cut up. I think it's probably about on a weekly basis. As we're thinking about making an investment in that area, are we going to consider that seems to be a hub for homeless folks to set up their tents and things like that? What are you guys already, what are the conversations that you guys are talking about to be able to protect this investment that we're going to do in the Alisal?
Right, and that's Caltrans own fence. Caltrans will be installing the fence under a separate, as part of a separate project that they have. That has been the discussion. What can we do to ensure that the fence will not be broken into or that there's constant maintenance to it? And so that's something that Caltrans, the initial discussions as we were initially having the fencing be part of this project, we were looking into the wrought iron fence. And unfortunately, with the funding, Caltrans is looking at a different type of fence that's also proved to last. And like I said, they are moving that installation as part of a separate project that Caltrans has. And
can we go to the proposed area for the fence? That'd be
It's just the new fencing will be to the northwest side of the underpass. And it'll be if you look at the top, there will be cobble, and then the fence will be installed at the top. But they're looking at the second from my left. They're looking at that type of fencing, which it to Caltrans it has proved to work when it comes to homeless encampments.
Yeah, I was gonna just to throw in that our intention too is as part of this, we've already started to engage the SORT team around the Sanborn project, especially with given the home key. So our intention is to work in these areas to have the SORT team kind of go out and talk to individuals. And sometimes, not always, but sometimes when you explain the importance of something and to respect it, sometimes that has results. So that's another thing that we can do. And I was gonna mention, I'm glad that they picked that second one because I have a lot of experience with fencing, and that one, I was whispering to Lisa that's the one that is most effective. Still can break in, but it's harder because I don't know if you can see, but the wires are pretty thick, thicker than a chain link fence. And you know, it's harder to kind of get enough cut out that you can slide in. Whereas wrought iron is a little bit easier to pull apart and cut through. So I think this omega fence, I think it's what they call it, will probably be a bit more effective.
And so so then hopefully, I mean, and I only say that because the good thing is that you guys are very knowledgeable about that area because of our SORT team goes out there frequently. So you know it's a huge challenge. And while it's good that we say that we're going to put this really strong fencing, I think just the commitment to know that the city is going to be able to be responsive as soon as the opportunity comes up where we're throwing all of these millions of dollars inside of this project. And I drive by this street every single day, and just about every couple days, and you know this to be fact, there's folks that are camping out on the other side of the area, which is a Caltrans area, and the fence is, you know, it's brand new, it's nice, and then, you know, you're coming in from the freeway and you're like, how did you guys get on the other side of that fence? All of that investment. So that's good to know that this is this was a fence that was designed with that purpose to be able to be for a really long time. So thank you for answering that. The other question that I have is there a reason, I know as we start to get ready, let's talk about the mural that's on Alisal. So I think you guys are aware that there was some pink paint that was thrown on that. Only partial of it was ever cleaned up. There's still a big glob of pink paint on there. Is there a reason why we didn't take care of all of that? Are we gonna use some of these funds to make sure that we clean that up as well? Was that the intent?
Yes, the project will be restoring the existing
okay. Mural. Good. That's good to know, because I didn't know about that anti-graffiti paint until that happened, where most of it came off, and I was like, yeah, I was so relieved, because that was really unfortunate. The other question that I have on that same topic is, I know we're talking about the trash cans. Who's gonna be collecting the trash that goes into those trash cans? The ones that will be on the Alisal?
Okay, that will most likely be an agreement, service between Republic Services and the city.
And then as far as like the murals that will be going on to the boxing gym that's over at Kloster Park, is there, because I know that we're also going to be making an investment in that area as well. I think it'd be really hard to kind of put them on the same schedule. But as we make additions, are we repairing anything that has to do with that building? No, we're not touching the building at all?
Through this grant, that is not proposed.
Well, with the repairs to the Kloster Park.
So I think, sorry, Murray, just because it's been brought up, Kristen is looking at that, and I think they are looking at a facilities evaluation to see what needs to be done. So I know that is in the works.
And that's the reason that I asked, because I think that there is assessment that's going to be done on that building. So, I mean, I think that if the public was told that the reason that we are kind of holding off on putting a mural on that building is because maybe there might be a potential for a bigger investment, I think that the public would be okay with that. But I just wanted to know that those discussions are happening.
They are happening. The mural has a very, I think Maria showed the timeline, so we have to meet that timeline. But I think whatever mural we put in it will be in a way that doesn't affect what other things that have to be done.
Okay.
So we would probably work with Kristen's staff and maybe even our building
Good.
Staff to recommend to make sure that there's not a conflict. And I know with the bread box, as part of the mural work we were doing, we actually repainted the outside, so we might do something similar.
All right, awesome, thank you. And then my last question is gonna be, for the bread box, in front of the bread box, there's, before you get to the sidewalk, and even the sidewalk is not in the best shape either, but is all of that gonna be redone? Is all that concrete gonna be redone?
Yes, and I forgot to include that there will be installation of permeable pavers along that front edge.
That was my last question. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Great minds think alike, because my question was on fencing style and making sure that we were using a fencing material that was less likely to be broken into. Just going to the area kind of between mine and Orlando's, around down Main Street, around the highway there, Caltrans put up chain link fence, and it is a disaster. So anything we can do to push Caltrans to be more mindful of that as they go in and do that is very, very helpful and appreciated. And I would be happy to make phone calls, just let me know. Does the public have any comment on this issue? Yeah, the public first. No comment from the public. We'll bring it back to council. The recommendation is to move it forward approve a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute a restricted grant agreement and any amendments with the California Department of Transportation for the CCLGP and sub-applications, establish a new CIP for the project, and appropriate the local match.
I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Okay.
So the agenda has no action. This item is for administrative report for informational purposes only. I think at the council we're going to approve it. But yeah, this is no action is necessary.
The motion is for us to send it to city council. That's the motion.
Okay. All right. Do you want to make that?
Yeah.
And I'll second it. Recommended for approval.
Okay. Any additional comments?
I'm going to give comments.
Okay. But,
I took several courses at Santa Cruz related to urban politics and policy, and one thing that was really fascinating but actually very disturbing to me was the role that murals and art in some ways have actually disproportionately impacted lower income communities, especially in larger cities like Los Angeles. And what I mean by that is traditionally communities that people of higher incomes didn't want to move into and live into because of stereotypes or whatever, suddenly had a newfound interest in those neighborhoods when beautiful murals went up. And what was happening, especially in Boyle Heights and communities similar to that, is the property owners and the landlords there all of a sudden saw a beautiful mural and they said, you know what, this is now a destination. And then commercial and residential rents went up significantly, and a lot of the local residents were pushed out. And one thing in particular that stood out to me in reading those cases was that one of the main issues the local artists had was that you had a lot of out-of-town artists coming in and artists from wealthy communities coming in and taking on these murals. I had no understanding or respect for that community. And what's important to note here locally is a Salinas artist probably doesn't have the same income as a Carmel artist, right? And so making sure that our local artists have this opportunity, once in a lifetime opportunity, to grow professionally and then later on have the ability with this experience to do a mural like this that's really technical is going to be important for us. I think this is an economic generator for us on many fronts if we get it done the right way and give our local artists an opportunity to excel here. So hopefully that's really taken into consideration. But other than that, I support the motion.
Thank you. Orlando, final comments?
Yeah. Thank you for all of the outreach that was done to select the artist. There was a lot of community engagement around trying to pick that artist. I know that the Arts Council also. I was going through Facebook and Instagram, and it was always on there. A lot of the local artists knew about it as well. I do think that when we talk about capacity issues, it's real. These are huge, vibrant murals that are going to be put here, and I'm glad that a lot of our youth youth and even local artists will get a chance to do this. This is great. I think that because I know the area so well, I mean, I live in that area and I've lived there my whole entire life, I am going to do everything that I can to be supportive of you guys and of this artwork, and obviously making sure that it stays beautiful, because this is a multi-million dollar investment, and it's gonna be beautiful once it comes online. And I think that we need to protect our investment the best we can. So I look forward to being as helpful as I can and supporting you guys. And thank you so much for all of the work that you guys are doing on this. I know that the residents of the Alisal are gonna, it's gonna be a destination after this, you know. So
well, hopefully,
I don't want. Yeah, thank you.
So I too want to touch on local artists, because we have a lot of great local artists here in town. And I think part of what we need to do as a council is put some money into our art fund, so that I understand that this particular project is very, has some complications to it that we need to get local artists trained for, but there's lots of other places within Salinas that we need art. And if we can put some money into that art fund so that we can get those accomplished and give our local artists the opportunity to do that, I think we should do it. I do want to point out that I loved that Caltrans came together with us to do these projects. I'm going to point out again, and I already have to Megan and Lisa, but I'm going to point out again that the overpass at Miranda is the focal point of the city, being at the Northridge Mall. It is where the sign "Welcome to Salinas" should be, and we need to think about how we get funding and how we beat on Caltrans door to make sure that is the next project that goes in to our city, because that is definitely a place where we need one, beautification and cleanup, but also it is the focal point of our city. So that's my comment on that. With that, let's go to a vote.
Yes.
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 Thank you. Okay, moving on to our next item, ID 22424, transfer agreement with the Transportation Agency for Monterey County, TAMC, for 11 parcels at the Intermodal Transportation Center. Michael.
Good afternoon, council members. Michael Gomez, Economic Development Analyst here with the Community Development Department. So it's gonna be kind of a refresher here. This did come to council in October, but this is pretty much authorizing the execute, or Mary, you already said that, but let's go. Oh, there it is. So a background of the project was in February 2017, the City of Salinas entered into a Memorandum of Understanding with TAMC, the Transportation Agency of Monterey County, to develop the surrounding areas of the Intermodal Transportation Center, also known as the Train Station Center, which is down here on, I think you're all familiar with it, but formerly Station Place, currently Station Place, but they also extended it to Lincoln Avenue. So the MOU called for the transit facility to serve as a stop for train service to locations outside of the region, as well as a regional bus service. So this image here is how it looked prior to the development that TAMC did through a grant that they received through Caltrans. So currently, TAMC has already completed their portion of the MOU, which is known as Package 1, which they went ahead and pretty much kind of rephased the whole entire thing. First, they acquired some privately owned properties, which are the 11 parcels in question. They extended the Lincoln Avenue into the Intermodal Transportation Center, added landscaping, parking stalls, lighting, bus shelter, benches, and bike racks. And I want to point out that I was a photographer for those pictures there. The total project was costed a little over $21.6 million. $20 million of those dollars were a grant through the obtained through Caltrans by TAMC from a traffic congestion relief program grant. This image here has the 11 parcels that you see in gray, two of which are kind of extend down to Lincoln now, which is one of the items that we want to do, acquire the property and make that Lincoln extension the right of way. So in October of 2021, council had already approved a transfer agreement with the condition of the ability to be able to redevelop it, because that grant had specific stipulations of what can be done after they received the grant. However, in spring 2022, we were notified by TAMC that the CTC would not support kind of a broad approval for development, as the LSL Vibrancy Plan kind of has that not official kind of proposal, it just has kind of an idea of what we want it to look like. So they may be, there may be a possibility that they can approve it once we give them an official proposal, but first we have to acquire those properties. So we are recommending that the city approve a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute the transfer agreement with TAMC for those 11 parcels at the ITC. So the ITC currently has a fund, and the non-departmental fund that currently there's budgeted $100,000 in there. However, due to the maintenance cost, we are kind of at a deficit. Last fiscal year, the general fund had to cover around $25,000 aside from what we get from leases there for the maintenance and repair of, you know, miscellaneous items that go wrong, windows get broken and so on, security, and kind of that general stuff there. So we will need to regroup, and once we acquire those properties, if approved later today at 4 during council, we will need to kind of amend the budget there and increase it and then see what we can do in order for us to be able to maintain the additional 11 lots. So our goal is to get this approved so the city has full control of those 11 parcels, and we will be responsible for those parcels, managing it, setting up signs, and as well as the main one is extending the right-of-way to Lincoln, which will you will see in council coming on a little bit further on once we get this approved and under our name. And I think that kind of covers the main portion. Is there any questions from anybody?
Orlando, questions?
No questions.
Anthony?
This may be a silly question, but does this have any impact whatsoever on the train services and the route and anything like that?
No, and actually the MOU kind of brings in the MST, so they're going to have some routes there once everything is kind of set and incorporated. Mm-hmm. They were in the original MOU with TAMC, the City of Salinas, and the ITC Center was formerly the redevelopment agency, but we are the successor agency. So no, there will be no impact.
When we accept ownership, does that allow us to then convert it to potentially zoned for housing?
So that's a tricky question because through the grant, Caltrans had stipulated that it must stay for parking, and we try to negotiate, or we couldn't go directly to Caltrans because we're not the official owners yet. So TAMC reached out to them and let them know what our plans were. There is going to be a debt of $6.65 million or up until July 2031 that their agreement ends. However, there is still a possibility that we may be able to develop once we give them an official proposal of this is what we plan on doing, and then we can go from there.
If I could just add, last fall, the City Council approved the rezoning of the parcels there at the Intermodal Transportation Center, converting it from public, semi-public, to mixed use, in anticipation that we do want to carry forward the vision in the Downtown Vibrancy Plan of looking at mixed use, transit-oriented development. However, we have hit a little hurdle here, but the CTC has indicated that they are definitely open to consider future development, but they would like to have an actual proposal to consider. The crux of the issue is the provision of parking for the train station and bus service. So it's balancing, you know, the intent of the original grant was to provide the parking facility improvements to serve the train station and customers. And so we'll just need to kind of take that one step at a time. But we're recommending that we go ahead and accept ownership because we do need to take control of the public right-of-way, the Lincoln Avenue extension, as well as the parking facility.
And if we're going to expand those right-of-ways, how does that impact the recent work that was done there in terms of all the construction they did there?
So we're just taking ownership of the improvements.
Oh.
And we would be responsible for their future maintenance.
Okay. And I'm just a little confused as to, I understand the future intent, but from just from financially speaking, why would we accept property that we don't know whether or not we can use for something other than parking if it's conditionally that we could only use it for parking right now?
So part of it is Lincoln Avenue is a road, a public road, and so it's appropriate for us to take ownership of that public right-of-way and access. And we do own property at the other property at the train station. So this is actually just completing our ownership of the parking facility, and we just have to take it one step at a time because the grant funds were intended for parking improvements. We need to continue to work through that with the CTC and Caltrans.
Okay, those are all my questions.
Thank you.
Taking that one step further, I can't talk today. I would suspect, given the current climate of housing, affordable housing and everything, that we could help push that through and that people are going to be much more willing as we move forward. But as I was recently told, you don't have a formal plan and therefore, you know, we can't give you money or we can't let you do it if you don't have a plan. We want it to be shovel ready. So I think we gotta move forward with that. Is there any public comment on this? Anything come through an email?
No.
Having no public comment, we'll bring it back for action. The recommendation was for us to forward this to City Council to approve a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute a transfer agreement with TAMSI for the 11 parcels at the ITC. Can I get a motion?
Sorry. Yeah, we're going to make the motion and then we're going to comments, correct?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Motion. I'd like to make a motion.
For approval?
Approval.
I'll second it.
Final comments. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, praying to the CTC gods that they allow us to change the usage of it because, I mean, this is transit-oriented development at its best. And so I was recently hearing a conversation at a housing conference about the myth that people say, well, we want to build jobs near people's work. Well, one partner drives south and one drives north, one drives east and one drives west. So really you're not building near your job. If you build near transit, then it's more, you know, to the benefit of the tenants and the community. So, but I'm very supportive of this and so I want to see it move forward.
Orlando, any final comments?
Yeah, it's good. Now it's ours, so now we can start having conversations about what we would like to see going forward. Obviously, we know that right now the name of the game is housing. So whatever we can do to see some developers maybe help out with these projects, that's something that we want to do. So thank you so much for the report. It was good seeing you, Mike.
First, Michael, I think you did a great job on the report, and I would say that part of this planning would have to include a parking garage, right, to make up their parking. So there's ways around. Flat parking is no longer what should be the norm, and we've just got to work our little magic to get around it. And you guys are great at that. With nothing else, any future agenda items anyone wants to see?
Yeah, and Megan? I did want to talk a little bit about the future agenda items, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
I wanted to explain, we're actually moving slightly based on what I understood from you. So if I misunderstood this, we can change back. But what I understood from this group is when things go to City Council, you want to hear them first and make a recommendation. So now, in talking with Patty, those items are consideration items for you to recommend moving them forward. I think the thing that got a little out of order was we were going to meet on the 2nd, and because it got pushed today, those items are actually going to be heard today, but in the future,
they would be recommendations to council.
That's how I understood. Now, if I misunderstood, let me know. Is that acceptable?
No, you understood it correctly. It's just that the agenda says no action, this item's for administration report.
Yeah, so there might have been a little miscommunication from Beatrice and myself, but Patty and Chris did bless that moving forward. So we will do that. And then Ernest requested that we also make sure that we have something attached to the agenda. So we're going to work to have, it may be sort of, in some ways, a regurgitation of the council agenda a week before. It may not have, fully edited because it gets routed to the various individuals, but it'll be enough for kind of like the finance committee agenda that will give you some deeper understanding of what's on the agenda.
Well, you just had, the one slide that was the Alisal Vibrancy with the Tamsi School, that slide. Even if it was just that slide, that's a great slide for us to be able to look at and go, oh, this makes so much sense, right?
It is, but I was actually the one that requested from Ernest to see if he can get a packet prior to me getting there an hour before or seeing it for the first time. So thank you. Yeah. I appreciate it. Anything you could get would be good.
And I will admit that it may be... on there when the agenda is posted, so I don't know that I can give you a week's head, but no. At least you have it before
this
meeting.
A couple days, even 24 hours would be better than nothing.
So when we post the agenda on Friday, we'll make sure that some type of packet is also posted. So
Megan, even if you guys have to put draft across it, that it's not the official thing we're going to see, but it's the working document, I think we're okay with that to be able to see something.
Yeah. And then if there's any other items you want to add or, study sessions, we also still will have our set meetings that are required for the HUD stuff usual, but we will also be adding these kind of consideration items that will be going to City Council.
One thing that I wanted to put on your radar for future agenda items is the rental registry discussion we had, because we had mentioned that it was going to come back to the council in May, and we talked about that in January. And so just putting that out there.
Yeah, we're actually fairly close to a draft ordinance, so we will come to this committee. We wanted to do some outreach and engagement, but if you want an update before we go out to do the formal outreach, we can do that. It's your choice. Or if you want to wait until after we do the outreach, and then we can update you on what occurred.
After the outreach is okay for me. I mean,
okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good. We'll make sure it's on.
Yeah.
Great.
That's good.
Thank you.
Doesn't matter. If we got something we want to change, we're going to try to change it regardless when you bring it to us.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan. Okay. With nothing further, I will adjourn this meeting.